Hi everyone, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Dan King.
I am Taeyang Kim.
We are the economists of Office of Sustainable Growth at the Bank of Korea. Lately, it's getting harder to ignore the ways our climate is changing. It's not just scientists talking about it. You can see it in the news headlines, and many of us are experiencing the effects firsthand. Hotter summers, sudden downpours, wildfires that spread farther and faster than before. All these kind of events are happening more often, and they are hitting harder these days. And the impacts of these events go well beyond the environment. They are disrupting food systems, public health, infrastructure, and even financial markets. It's a clear sign that climate change isn't a distant threat. It's already reshaping how we live and work. That's exactly why we're launching this interview series to help unpack what's happening and better understand the climate risk we're facing right now. By talking with leading climate experts across disciplines ranging from science to finance, we hope to share deeper insights that can support across government, business, and everyday life. Today, we're pleased to welcome Dr. Kai-Kun Huber. He's an adjunct assistant professor at Columbia University's Climate School and a senior research scholar at the International Institute for Applied Systems Analysis, so-called EASA, in Austria. His research focuses on extreme weather and compound climate events, and he has published widely in top journals, including Nature Climate Change.
In today's conversation, we'll dive into the science behind compound climate events, what they are, why they are becoming more frequent, and what they mean for how we manage risk in a changing climate.
Dr. Kornhuber, thank you for joining us today. To start off, could you tell us a bit about yourself, your current position and research areas?
Many thanks for this invitation. So I'm a theme lead at the International Institute for Applied Systems Analysis in Austria, and an associate research scientist at Columbia Climate School. And my research is concerned with understanding the physical relationships that lead to the most severe extreme weather events and to understand that change under different emission pathways. So my goal really is to understand future climate risks and to provide physical insights to avoid these risks for different societal sectors.
As we just mentioned in the opening, South Korea has been experiencing unusual weather, extreme heat waves and sudden downpours last summer. We have also experienced a severe drought this spring. How has the weather been recently in your region?
So as in many regions globally, Austria has been experiencing very warm and very dry conditions over the past months. At the same time, we have experienced very severe precipitation events, record-breaking rainfall that has led to severe flooding last September over large parts of the country. And the combination of these events is causing more severe risks, so-called compound events, things that we with science are able to better explain to avoid future risks.
How do scientists understand the link between climate change and the rising frequencies or severity of these extremes? Are these just anomalies or signs of deeper shift in the climate system?
So for many extreme weather events, in particular extreme heat waves and extreme rainfall events, the physical mechanisms that link a warming atmosphere, a warming planet, to more severe events, so more frequent and more intense heat waves and more record-breaking rainfall events are very well understood. And luckily, we can rely on long data sets from stations that show the increase in such events over many parts of the world. So with statistical tools, we can say without a doubt that the increase in these events is unusual. And then with our physical understanding and relying on complicated climate models that mimic the physical relationships, we can compare the current situation where we have an unusually high amount of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere with conditions where these greenhouse gases are absent. And comparing these two scenarios, we can then attribute the increase of certain weather events to anthropogenic factors, such as the emissions from fossil fuel burning and other sources of greenhouse gases. So in particular, heat waves, but also other effects like drought events, and as I said, extreme precipitation can be attributed to anthropogenic climate change.
All right. As these kinds of changes become more common, we keep hearing the term climate risk. Could you explain what that really means in practice? Maybe share a few examples, like how it shows up in a real world.
So climate risk, of course, is very strongly associated with societal impacts or impacts on biosphere, on natural systems. And it essentially refers to a situation where something that we value is in danger and under a certain probability. So if we talk about the climate risk from heat waves, we're talking about the detrimental effects heat waves can have on the health of elderly and young childs, or maternal health of pregnant women, or the risk to infrastructure, for instance, rails that might bend when they expand under extreme heat, or other engines that are not working anymore under specific severe climate conditions. So these are situations that we want to avoid. These are situations that become more frequent due to climate change. So certain systems that have been built under conditions that were more moderate are now at risk of experiencing situations that are dangerous, essentially. And the field of climate risk aims at understanding hotspots where certain events become more frequent, more severe, to avoid these situations in the future and to adapt to be more resistant and better prepared in case these situations arise.
Okay, up to now, we've been talking about risks from individual events, like a flood or a heat wave. But I know your research focuses on something more complex, compound events. Could you explain what that means and maybe give us a real-world example of how these overlapping events can cause even bigger impact?
So compound events are a specific type of climate hazard. They essentially emerge from the combination of several individual hazards, creating new, often unexpected risks to societies. So an example would be a closely related occurring and very close temporal subsequence tropical cyclone, for instance. So multiple tropical cyclones affecting one particular region in a short sequence, or the combination of different hazards affecting one particular area. So a wildfire that would expose soils at mountain hills, close the soils up. So if a rainfall event occurs right after, there's a higher risk of mudslides, for instance. A recent example would be the very dry and hot summer, for instance, that Europe experienced in 2018. So in this case, drought conditions and hot conditions occurred simultaneously and affected agriculture in a severe way. So with climate change, where multiple hazards see an increase in frequency and magnitude, there is overall a higher likelihood that individual hazards occur either in very close spatial relationship or temporal relationship, so they happen very closely together, and the combination of both hazards then makes the situation even more severe. And some of these events can be physically related. So the example of a drought and a heat wave is something we understand very well. Drought conditions are very often also very hot conditions because the physical mechanisms are very closely related. In other cases, things just happen more or less by chance because both of the individual hazards see an increasing trend, their co-occurrence becomes more likely. So an example of this would be, for instance, a tropical cyclone destroying an area, leaving a lot of puddles, wet soils, and so on, and then a heat wave that occurs right after, where the humidity from the water increases the heat stress due to high humid heat levels. And in addition, people that would need to clean up the tropical cyclone damage are exposed to the heat conditions because they have to work outside. So these types of situations just increase risks and in turn are fairly complicated to assess because of the complex interactions of the extremes that open new impact channels, and also the necessity to understand the physical dynamics of multiple hazards and to estimate their frequency and magnitude increase in a correct way.
I mean, that's really eye-opening, especially how the combination of events can push things past a tipping point. Why do you think we are seeing more of these compound events now? Is it mostly because the climate is warming, or are there other factors driving this kind of increase?
So for most of these events, climate is a prime factor. So as I explained earlier, heat waves and rainfall events in many parts of the region, many parts of the world, can be directly attributed to climate change. And if you see increasing trends and two different event types and you have a limited number of days per year available, the likelihood of seeing them shortly after another is just increasing, which, you know, gives rise to these types of compound events. In addition to that, of course, we do see other global trends like expansion of cities into risk areas, or yeah, infrastructure that is built close to shores where sea level rise and tropical storms, for instance, could combine to cause more risks. So for most of these compound extremes, climate change is the main driving factor, but of course the risk has also other components which are also including the ways that we as society develop and spread out to new areas that might be under risk.
Okay, hearing that, it seems these kind of risks are far more complex than they might initially appear. From your perspective, why is it especially important, not just for scientists, but also for decision makers in sectors like business and finance, to better understand and prepare for compound risk?
Overall, we as a society should be interested in increasing our knowledge about risky situations in order to be better prepared. And the finance sector has a long tradition of stress testing and risk assessment to multiple potential scenarios and factors. And more recently, climate risk stress testing has become more and more a state-of-the-art practice within the finance sector. There has been a lot of interest in this. But these have mostly been built on these traditional types of risk assessments, these univariate single hazard risk assessments, which really need to be expanded towards compound events in order to capture the full risk landscape. And that is not so trivial. A lot of expert knowledge is needed to design these scenarios that might be relevant for specific areas. But if we do not include these types of more complex event combinations, a large part of the risk that we are facing in the future will be missed. So a lot of effort should be put into expanding these stress testing frameworks to really account for compound risks. in order to be better prepared for future climate change.
When it comes to actually assessing or preparing for this risk, do you think our current tools and models are keeping up? Are we really capturing how complex and interconnected these events are? And if not, what do you think needs to change? How can you do a better job of managing these kinds of risks going forward?
So I do see a lot of positive developments. There's a lot of interest in understanding these new complex climate risks that in many regions have not been seen before. So conversations like the one that we are having, I think, are a very important part of this progress. There are other initiatives that, you know, get people from the finance sector and climate scientists together to improve models, climate models, but also improve on the climate scientist side the knowledge about what exactly is needed on what resolution and space and time in order to make these stress testing frameworks better. But the progress needs to happen on all sides at the same time. So while the recognition on the applied side is increasing, so the recognition on the finance sector side that compound events do play a major role in future climate risks, climate scientists also need to work towards making climate models better on a high spatial and temporal resolution and with a better representation of the tails of the distribution, so the very extreme events, in order to provide more accurate risks, risk assessments for future climate changes under different climate scenarios.
Okay, this has been such a helpful conversation. Before we wrap up, is there any one message you want to share with the public or policymakers watching this interview?
I'm really happy that these types of conversations are occurring. I think there should be more of these events, workshops, conferences, maybe joint publications, joint project work among the finance sector and academia in order to really push forward compound event science and to make it usable for different sectors. A lot of knowledge is also needed, as I said, on the climate scientist side to tailor their research initiatives towards aspects that are really needed on the more applied side. So I think this would be one message, a call for more collaboration across the private sector and academia in order to avoid these future risks.
Okay, Dr. Kunuber, thank you for joining us today and sharing your insights. This has been a really informative conversation, from understanding how climate change is driving more extreme and compound events to why it's so important to rethink how we assess and manage the compound risk. To everyone watching, we hope this helped you better understand what compound climate events and risk mean and why they matter.
Thanks again, and stay tuned for more conversations next time.
Bye-bye.